Mr. Bergeron's on. Don't forget the popcorn, Frank.
Coming, dear.
Okay, I'm going to talk a little bit about assisted living dues, things to do if you're thinking about an assisted living. One of the first things we always tell our clients is you need to read the agreement and always have an elder law attorney review the agreement before you sign it. Very important to do that. You also want to ask about fees upon admission, and then how often do those monthly fees increase. You also need to know about the service plan, which is the plan of care that's adapted for the senior when they come in, of the amount of services that they're going to need. And if more service is needed, how much does that fee increase with each service need? You want to ask if it's okay to bring in private help from a home care agency. Say mom is sick and she's not her usual self and she needs a little bit more than what's offered. Is it okay for you to hire someone to come in privately, maybe for a few days, a week or so, till she's back to her normal baseline? You want to know, again, how the medications are dispensed. And is there an extra fee if there is an extra medicine added? You also want to know if what kind of a notice needs to be given if the senior is going to move out. And that's very important because in our practice, I will give you just one little item that we went through. We had a gentleman who moved into an assisted living. He signed a contract. He had to put 3 months' rent up front, and then he had to have an amount set aside of 3 months. So that's 6 months total of money. He slipped and fell the first week he was there and broke his hip. And not that it was planned, but he ended up, when he went into the hospital, he had a stroke. He ended up having to go to long-term care. Now his family, he's gone into long-term care. They have an apartment and an assisted living that they have 6 months worth of money that they have agreed to. So needless to say, they did have an attorney who was able to go in and negotiate, but you really don't know how important it is to make sure an attorney looks over before you sign any document for any type of a contract involving assisted living. Ask if they have a respite program. Do they allow someone to come in and stay for a couple of months? Say you and your husband want to go down, or your friend want to go down to Florida for a month and get away. Could your senior come in and try it, be there for a month or 2 months? And usually some places have apartments where they're fully furnished and their medications get taken care of and you pay a monthly fee. It's just another way to find out if it's going to work before you take that step. Also, you want to know if there are any government-assisted units in the facility. There are some facilities that have government funding to assist people as their money runs out. It goes at a lower rate. And also, you want to ask what happens when the money runs out. Does mom or dad have to move? What do I do? I think all of these things are very important, and you should talk to the staff members like Dixie and Jazz before making advanced steps or going any further, because you need to make sure that the answers you get to these questions satisfy the needs that you're looking for.
When is it time to move into an assisted living? Again, when is it time? And everybody has a different threshold of when it's time to move in. Some people realize it's time when they realize the house has gotten too big and it's just too much for them to manage and they don't want to live alone anymore. But that doesn't always happen, and more times than not, it takes a situation, whether it's a medical situation or maybe a winter that's just a little too tough, they've lost some power, difficult to get in, and everybody says, okay, this is the last winter you're going to be in this house, because next winter we're not going to worry about the snow plowing, we're not going to worry if there's food, if the power goes out. So you want to look, step back and say, okay, is this the time to do it? Is someone not managing well at home? Could home care come in and help solve the problem? It's a possibility, and again, you've got to look at the whole situation. As someone with memory loss, they begin to show signs that they're not showering well, they're not eating well anymore, and that again becomes a safety issue. And the one question is, we always ask many of our clients is, what would you do if there was a fire? If somebody says, I don't know, or I would try to put it out, then you know that they're really not safe at home, and decisions have to be made again about moving to an assisted living, because there could be an emergency and someone may not know what to do in that situation. You can start by bringing services into the home and trying that and see how that goes. And if that works well, then again, start your search for the assisted living. Have that plan B. You've got services in the house. You start looking so that if plan A doesn't work anymore, you're not in a crisis. Because when you're looking or making decisions in a crisis, sometimes they're not the best decisions because it's all emotion-based. When you can make a decision on an assisted living, tour it, tour again, come back and look at it, you're able to make a better decision when you're not under the gun or you only have time limited because someone is in the hospital and you've got to make a decision, or someone is in a rehab setting and you've got to make a decision very fast. So we always say, start the tours, start asking the questions when you've got time to think, and then ask more questions. And also, when families get calls from neighbors or other family members that things are happening in the house, it's not going as smoothly, then this is the time to move out of the house. It's not easy to do. It's not easy to convince someone to downsize, but it is the right time to make that decision, and it is the right time to make it happen.
What type of changes to the medical care of an aging relative do you need to look at? An assisted living is a social setting providing 24/7 oversight and staff available to assist. Your relative will continue to see their primary doctor if they wish. Your relative will also continue to see their specialist, their cardiologist, the ophthalmologist, maybe their podiatrist. Your relative can continue to have VNA services in the assisted living for physical therapy, occupational therapy, and nursing if needed. Just as if they went into the hospital, were being discharged home with VNA services, they would be discharged back home here, and the VNA could come in and provide those extra services. There is an RN in the building at an assisted living, but her job is limited. Her function, because of state regulations, is to assess. She actually cannot do hands-on skilled care. By that, I mean if you have a diabetic, she's not allowed to go up and do a finger stick or give them insulin if they need it. She's not allowed to change a dressing on a wound that needs to have daily dressing changes. She cannot take a blood pressure. She's not allowed. She can, if there is a health agency in the building, a lot of assisted livings have a health clinic where you are able to go over and be checked out on certain days at certain hours. That is when those things can be done, a blood pressure check or a temperature check. I think one of the biggest things is to understand, as the medical needs increase, the word assisted living needs to be looked at, because they may have progressed to a point where they now need much more assistance, not limited assistance. And I think that's an important piece. One of the things in an assisted living is, if same dad started to get very weak. And he was needing one person to help him get his balance and stand up, and then he could go with his walker. Well, now his condition has declined, and he needs two people to get him up out of the chair. The assisted living is not geared under regulations to have a two-assist person living in the facility. That person now meets qualifications to go to a long-term care nursing home setting. You can bring in extra services to help, and there is a thing called a SARA lift or a mechanical lift that one person can help them stand up with that, and it's still only a one-person transfer. But it depends on the regulations of the facility that they're in. You also need to know that is the disease and the memory loss, if they have a dementia, is progressing. Safety is the biggest concern. But here again, they have a dementia unit, a special unit devoted to the care of memory loss, which means by moving there are more attendants available to take care. They're there to redirect. They're there to provide the safety that's needed. You also need to know if the nursing needs increase and they are at the memory unit, you can bring in extra services again, but it becomes a time where they really require 24/7 nursing monitoring, then now you're looking at a long-term care setting. I think that you also need to be aware that things like diabetes, people who take cardiac meds and need to have their blood pressure or their pulses taken before they can take a dosage. If they no longer can do that, it can get very expensive for private help to come in and out to do that on a daily basis.
Also, in many places, such as Carriage House, you can bring in, if you're in the independent or assisted units, you can also bring in help, so that you don't always need to move to the memory unit right away, and you can bring in your own private help from an agency to help allow someone to still age in place in their apartment, because if they need more help than is in the contract, you can bring that in privately.